UFO's and the Spirit of the Mock-Wa-Mosa by Dennis M. Morrison, Sr. This was published originally in UFO Universe Magazine back in 1989. There exists in the Northeast woodland culture an evil that strikes fear even into the hearts of many Indians yet today, but especially those of the Chippewa culture. The evil is known as the Bearwalker. Like the Mitiwiwin and the Shaking Tent, the Bearwalker finds its roots in prehistory, though it is still actively spinning its mystical web today. The Bearwalker goes by the Indian name of Mock-Wa-Mosa and is said to be the Indian equivalent of white man's witchcraft. In a videotaped interview with Chief John McGonigan of the Makedo Indian Reservation, the chief spoke with some apprehension of his personal memories of the Mock-Wa-Mosa. Chief Nagagwan explained that the Bearwalker used their powers to settle grudges. It is, however, a grudge settler which reacts only upon the Indians and cannot be turned on the whites. The practitioners are said to be very sly indeed. In modern times, cult members are known to pose as good Christian churchgoers, but the Mock-Wa-Mosa, they practice on the side. The power imbued in the modern practitioner comes down from ancient times and is passed from one generation to another. The manner of transfer is quite simple, but varies according to circumstances. When a practitioner feels that he or she is near death's door, they call to themselves a kinsman and simply tell that person, "I have something for you." The power cannot be refused, and the power must be used. Through the use of the Mock-Wa-Mosa powers, the possessor must kill at least one person per year, or the power will turn on its possessor and kill him or her. Now, another method of transfer of power was related by Archie Megenkamp from Michigan's Upper Peninsula to Richard M. Dorson in his book Bloodstoppers and Bearwalkers. He related, and I quote, "You can catch one if you have the right medicine. You chew a sprinkle of the medicine, on yourself, and you wait for a bear walk. Then you put your arms around it, and it's all naked except for a string of beads around the neck. Then it asks you to let it go, and it promises you anything, to suckle you, to teach you the bear walk. Then if you let it go, you go and learn from it, like from a professor. They caught one here once, that way. I'd like to be a bear walk," he said. "If you shoot them, you can't ever catch them. You can't bring them to your premises, and they must always go home to die. You don't find anything when you shoot them, but they die off some distance," end quote. Chief Nagagwan related that, among other things, the person with this power can transfer themselves into any shape. Most frequently, the choice is a bear. In this form, they stalk forth to revenge wrongs done to themselves or to kinsmen, and they have tremendous power indeed. If in this form they even pass by an innocent bystander, that person, unless of extremely strong constitution, is knocked unconscious by the sheer power concentrated in this being. Alec Philemon was a personal witness to this incredible concentration of power, by which even future events can sometimes be predicted. Philemon related, "When I was 13, maybe 14, I was going with my mother and sister to visit a sick woman. We left there about 11 o'clock in the evening, and I saw the fire right on the main road, which goes to the church now. My mother and sister fell right over. I caught my mother. She said, 'That must have been a bear walk. It was much too much for us.' And then she said, 'You'll live the longest.' My sister fell first, and she died first, too. They both died of the flu in 1918. That woman we visited, about a half an hour after we got home, we heard the bell ring, and that woman was dead," end quote. As illustrated in the above story, brilliant lights are oftentimes associated with the bear walker. When a person transforms to the bear and walks upright through the forest, it searches in search of its victims, the beast is ablaze with brilliant light. One of the more common shapes to be assumed is that of a huge fireball. Chief Nagagwan recalled one evening watching the barn by his house. "I remember going down by the woods by my house. You could just see the trees all light up." A lady, Nancy Picard, of French Indian descent, related that her father died on the night of January 4th, 1914. She recalled that she and various other members of her family saw the Mock-Wa-Mosa light hanging in the woods in the back of the house. She said that it looked like a round ball of light and that some of the family went to investigate. They were so overtaken by the chills that they were forced to turn back, but they all knew of its power. Nancy also told that a person who has the power can take all forms, but the favored form were the bears or owl. Light generally is present with these manifestations. Now I'm going to quote again from Nancy Picard, and pay attention in particular to the description of the ball of light. Nancy is speaking about a young girl who took very sick. She related to Mrs. Dorson the following. People watched all day to keep anyone away. Every night they'd see a light hanging in line with the trees, and it would dance around like a flame. An old woman, Mrs. Elijah, tried to get it time and time again when the body was in the house. Dan borrowed money from the Odana, Wisconsin, to contact a person who had power to counteract the evil. He was afraid the whole family would be wiped out, that new medicine was supposed to kill the effect of the original dose. It was quite a notorious affair. Even the white people in the county were interested, she told. Now remember the lights and pay attention to that through the rest of this account, of these accounts, because we'll come back to that in a little bit. When the bear walker makes someone die, the family goes to the grave on the fourth night to protect the corpse, and this also provides another opportunity to end the evil power. The Mock-Wa-Mosa was required to go to the grave 4 days after in order to get back the medicine that he or she used. On one such occasion, a group of families saw the fireball coming. They were scared and all fainted, save for one old man who, by the way, died at 98 years old. He reportedly glanced up and saw the bear stomping on the grave and spitting fire. He is said to have grabbed hold of the bear, and it vanished. In his grips it vanished, but in his grips was an old woman bear walker. She was said to have buckskin bags all over her, and that she had a bearskin hide on her. It is also believed that whoever the bear walker kills, it must take a toe or finger to put into one of these bags. The desecration of the corpse was further borne out by Archie Meganump, who related the following again in Bloodstoppers and Bear Walkers. If you don't have the right medicine, they put you to sleep, even if you have a gun, and walk right past you to the patient. It's as if you were paralyzed. They go every fourth night, and on the sixth night, the patient is finished. You can be in a room with your wife, and you'll fall asleep, and when the bear walk comes in, there's nothing you can do. You can hear them go out. They can take any shape, fowl or animal or even insect. That grasshopper you kick may be it. On the fourth night after they kill the patient, he said, they go to the grave and you can hear the carcass rise right up out of the casket, and they cut off the fourth and fifth finger and the tongue tip and put it in with their victim's set. End quote. The eye, finger, or tongue. It must come from the right side of the victim. If for some reason the Mock-Wa-Mosa cannot get to the grave, it will die after a period of 4 months. Now, one last eyewitness account is on my desk, which involves the mysterious light phenomenon connected with the Mock-Wa-Mosa. Alec Philemon told that there were three of us, he said, one a couple years older, coming back from Bark River at nighttime. We saw a flash coming from behind us. The older fellow said, it's a bear walk. Let's get it. I'll stand on the other side of the road and you stand on this side. He continued, we stood there and waited. I saw it about 50 feet away from us. It looked like a bear, but every time he would breathe, you could see gusts of flames. My chum fell over in a faint. When the bear walk, all the ground gave way like when you walk on soft mud or on moss. He was going where he was going. End quote. Now, I asked you to pay particular attention to the description of the ball lights. The Northeast Woodlands have always been particularly prone to UFO sightings. Many of these sightings match or are similar to phenomena associated with the Mock-Wa-Mosa. Of course, not all UFO activity in the large area of the United States and Canada can be attributed to this, but it is quite possible that some can be. After all, the bear walk is still commonly practiced but is unknown to most whites. When the ethereal light is seen, the native mind would attribute it to the bear walk. However, UFO would promptly flash into the mind of most modern people. This calls to mind a time when my ex-wife, then fiancé, Kathy and I were driving a desolate stretch of old U.S. 23 near Tuttle Marsh, Michigan. Tuttle Marsh is a good place to stay away from, particularly at night, although I love it there, day or night. We were driving along and observed a bright flash of red light coming from the north, heading south, then arching down into the woods where it hung briefly before disappearing. Not being familiar at that time with the Indian culture, I thought right away UFOs. Now, in 1966, the Native Americans may have been sitting back while having quite a laugh at the expense of the general American populace, which was anxious and nearing panic. For you see, in 1966, the United States was undergoing a truly large UFO flap that seemed centered in the Northeast. You could not turn on the TV or radio without hearing about the phenomenon. Particularly affected was Michigan and New York, and perhaps you remember. At that time in our travel through history, the government felt people were incapable of hearing the truth about UFOs. And come to think of it, years later, not much has changed in that respect, has it? The government, being pressed for an explanation from all around, hired Dr. J. Allen Hynek to play the dupe for them. He announced to the world that the ignorant folk up in the Northeast were seeing perhaps nothing but swamp gas, an explanation that was rejected by most of the thinking public. No satisfactory explanation has indeed ever been published as to what was really being cited. Rather than something from outer space, perhaps it was something quite down to earth, which finds its origins in the ancient powers of the Northeast woodlands and in the powers of the mind. Let me relate to you one sighting of hundreds that sound in modern terms very much like the balls of light associated with the Mock-Wa-Mosa. It was on March 20th, 1966, in Southeast Michigan. The Manor family was sitting down to Sunday dinner in their two-story white farmhouse on McGinnis Road. A hollow and a creek separated the house from a 300-acre swamp. And present that evening were Mr. and Mrs. Manners, two of their married daughters and their husbands, and Ronald, Frank Manners' 19-year-old son. They were already seated at the table when the dogs began howling in the yard. Mort Young, in his book UFO Top Secret, published in 1967, best captured the mood of excitement surrounding those events. He reported Manor went outside to quiet the dogs, but they were in a frenzy. A ball of fire arched across the sky. Manor decided it was a shooting star until it halted its plunge in midair just above a cluster of trees in the swamp. Lights flickered at either end of the fiery ball, then it plummeted behind the trees, a ruddy glow marking its location. The rest of the family joined Manor outside. They could see the faint glow, see the brush painted red by its reflection. And without waiting to take flashlights or guns, Frank and Ronnie Manor started down the gentle rise to the swamp. They knew every inch by heart, having hunted deer in it. Frank and Ronnie Manor plodded through the knee-high muck, barely able to see where they put their feet. Ahead, a flickering glow silhouetted a knoll. At eye level, 500 yards in front of them, a football-shaped gray object, the length of a car, shimmered in the darkness. It rested on a cushion of haze. About 8 feet above the mud, the object suddenly burned bloody red, and then the lights blinked out. The incidents of that spring and summer will be long etched in the minds of many. One should not overlook the possibility that at least these sightings had their origin right here on good old planet Earth. A note that was published also by the editor with this article said, the thought-provoking article by Dennis M. Morrison originally appeared in Tim Beckley's UFO's Universe, 1993. That's wrong. It was in the 1989. And gives pause to consider that some of the UFO sightings in the Northeast Michigan woodlands may not be extraterrestrial, but may actually be Mock-Wa-Mosa, the manifestation of a very unique Native American spiritual energy.